Hello everyone, I'm Sir NG Javier, and today we'll be discussing our third lesson before the semifinals for our purposive communication subject. So let's proceed. So this discussion will be focused on ethical persuasion and persuasive techniques. Let's discuss the ethics of persuasion. In here it is stated that persuasion is unethical if it is for personal gain at the expense of others or for personal gain without the knowledge of the audience. Simply put, when you try to convince people, of course you have an end goal. You have something in your mind, you have a purpose, you know. You're doing it for something. And if you're doing persuasion for personal gain at the expense of other people, you know, it's like you're taking advantage of them. You're going to take advantage of them, you know, iisahan mo sila, like what scammers do, you know, yung fraud. So they fool people and bait them on something, and then in the end, they will be the one to take advantage of them. So that's unethical. In other words, for personal gain without the knowledge of the audience. If you're going to convince an audience, you have to make them aware of the reason why you are convincing them. How will they benefit from this? Furthermore, some methods of persuasion are wholly written off as unethical, meaning there are a lot of techniques that are considered to be unethical, meaning it's not humane, it's not moral, like coercion, brainwashing, or torture. So these are some of the most unethical techniques of persuasion that are used by different sectors of communities. Now, ethical persuasion has a series of common characteristics that are missing in unethical persuasion. It seeks to achieve the following three goals. So if you want to make sure that the way you persuade people, the way you convince them to believe in you, to agree with you, or to follow your advice, you have to make sure that you follow these goals. First one is explore the other person's point of view, meaning to say you're not just imposing them what you believe in. Hindi mo sila pinipilit na parang ito ang tama, ito ang paniwalaan nyo. One goal of ethical persuasion is you explore their thoughts too, meaning to say you try to understand where they are coming from, you know, why are they believing in this, how they look at things, how they understand things, how they see things, you know. So ethical persuasion is also exploring the other side of the argument, you know, other side of the topic. Next one is explaining your viewpoint. Now, as I have said, in ethical persuasion, you try to understand the viewpoint of your audience. But of course, after trying to understand them, you explain your viewpoint. You know, it's like, okay, gets ko na kung sa akin nagagaling, gets ko kung anong gusto nyo sabihin, ano pinaniwalaan nyo, pero ito kasi ang sa akin. So, that's how you do it in ethical persuasion. And then finally, create resolutions. You know, you finally understand how what they believe in, and then you explained what you believe in. Now, how can you meet halfway? You know, how can you resolve the disagreements? So these are the three goals of ethical persuasion: understand them, make them understand you, and meet halfway. Now, in our aim to achieve ethical persuasion, we have different techniques that we can use. One of them is the TEAR test of Baker and Martinson. It helps the public relation practitioners to define ethical persuasion. So, how is it done? So, it's an ethical persuasive speech must have all of the following components. So, T stands for truthfulness, you know, how correct is the message, how correct is the content of the message, and then A is for authenticity of the persuader, meaning, are you genuine with your goals, with your purpose? Are you not just doing this persuasion because gusto mo lang ng personal gain, ikaw lang ang makikinabang, ganun. And then R, respect for the audience. Okay, do you really believe your persuasion is important for your audience? Beneficial ba talaga sa kanila? Makikinabang ba sila kapag nakumbinsin mo sila na maniwala sa'yo? And then E, equity of the persuasive appeal, meaning to say, what's the persuasive technique na ginamit mo? Anong ginamit mong technique? Baka naman kasi mamaya ang ginamit mo ay puro pathos, you know, emotional. Puro emotional ang atake mo, emotions ang atake. Meaning to say, you convince them by just manipulating their emotions. Baka naman unfair yun. Baka naman they also need to know about the logic, you know, yung the truth, the facts. Baka hindi pwedeng puro emotion lang. So, they get to decide better kung mag-agree ba sila o hindi sa'yo. Okay? So, that's the TEAR test by Baker and Martinson. Another Another technique is by Fitzpatrick and Cothier. They developed a series of questions that must be honestly answered to determine how ethical a pitch is. So these are the following questions. For what purpose is the persuasion being employed? So what's the purpose? Is it for personal gain? Is it for the benefits of others? So yun lang naman yun. And then, toward what choices and with what consequences for individual lives is persuasion being used? Meaning, what aspect of your audience life is being affected by this? You know, ito ba ay about their health? You know, their personal lives, you know? Or baka naman, if this is on a national level, benefit, ganun. So what aspect is being affected in their lives, your audience? And then finally, does the persuasion in this case contribute to or interfere with the decision-making process of the target audience? Meaning to say, when you, in your persuasion, as you try to convince them, do you think this persuasion will affect their decisions? And do you think the impact of this persuasion will be to help them make good choices? Or baka naman, this will be for your personal gain only at pang niloloko mo sila, like how scammers work. Okay, so these are the three questions that according to Fitzpatrick and Gauthier should be genuinely answered by the persuader, by the speaker. Kasi if you genuinely answer this and all the answers are positive, then probably you're doing ethical persuasion. Okay, now let's talk about persuasive techniques. So we talked about Aristotle's rhetorical appeals in our previous discussion, and we said there that there are three general types of persuasions that you can use to convince people, but there are actually more specific strategies where you can use to convince people. Okay, so again, a writer or speaker uses different ways to persuade people, and using these techniques can help them form evidence-based logical conclusions, opinions, and arguments. Okay, so what are these? So I have here 16 persuasive techniques. They are very easy to understand as you just look at the terms here. Basic lang. Sure lang kung gets yun agad ko anong ibig sabihin nito. But let's just discuss them on a breeze para lang mas malinaw. So attacks. Pag sinabi natin attacks, this is a persuasive technique which can be an attack to the opponent or an attack to the idea. Now, if you could remember, we talked about logical fallacies. Yung rhetorical fallacies were in. One of those is the ad hominem. Meaning, you attack the person. You attack the person instead of attacking the topic. Okay? Attacking the argument of the opponent. So, in this case, attacks can be allowed as long as you make sure that you're not going overboard. Meaning, hindi ka nagiging ad hominem. You can attack the opponent in a sense na parang point out the pang unpreparedness of the opponent, pang hindi mo masyadong na-research ang topic mo, I think you're not fully aware of the issue right now, mga ganun. Pwede yung ganun. Pero, of course, beyond attacks sa ganun, ay pwede maging ad hominem na. Sabi dito, anyone who judges other people based on race is unfair and foolish. So, this one now is attacking the opponent. That maybe your opinion is racist, you know, and anyone who is racist is unfair and foolish. So that's an attack, okay? A direct attack to the opponent. And again, you can do this on an idea as well, okay? Yeah, actually, mas better kung sa idea mo siya gagawin kasi nga, mas mukhang nakikinig ka at buo yung understanding mo sa pinaglalaban mo kasi nga, kaya mong basagin yung idea ng iba, okay? So again, that's attack. The second one is cliche. Surely you have heard about the word cliche. Di ba pag sinabi, cliche naman yan. May iba nga sinasaya pa. Cliche as it may sound. Yung mga ganun, di ba? So ano ba yung cliche? This is a term that has been overused to the extent that they are commonly understood by society. Meaning, kapag sinabi mo to, dahil nga cliche siya, lagi siyang nagagamit. Okay? At dahil lagi siyang nagagamit, everyone in the society, in the community, knows the meaning of this word. Okay? It can be a word or it can be a statement, yung mga ganun, yung pang mga kagaya nito. It is not the destination, but the journey. So, surely you have heard of this statement before na nakinig nyo na to. Maybe nakita nyo sa mga libraries, sa mga quotations and all. What it means is that the journey or the experiences you get along the way as you try to reach your goal is more important than the actual destination, than your actual goal. Okay, so yun lang naman yun. So, cliche. And cliches are actually effective persuasive techniques because since this is common knowledge, kumbaga pang alam na nga siya ng everyone in society, kapag sinabi mo siya, madali lang nagigets yung point mo. Okay, so that's the benefit of using a cliche. Next one is emotive language from the word emotion. So here, words that are used to create an emotional impact or response from the audience purposely. So para tong pathos, yung sinasabi ni Aristotle, so the writer uses emotive language to have a great emotional impact on the audience. And of course, if you use words that appeal to emotions, mas nagiging engaged yung audience mo. Mas nakukuha mo sila. Diba? Nakakakuha ka ng simpatya. This disaster situation will worsen unless we do something about it. You're highlighting the importance of doing something about the situation. You know, this disastrous situation. So, gumamit ka ng salitang disastrous. Disaster, parang siyang ganun. It can cause us disasters. You know, will worsen unless we do something about it. So, by saying disastrous situation will become worse, worsened, eh, napaparamdam mo sa tao yung seriousness nitong topic na to. Okay. So, may emotional appeal siya. Okay. Next one is exclusive from the word exclude. So, this is the technique that excludes somebody else through the words they use. And we can recognize this by the presence of pronouns they, them, and those. Look at the example here. It's all their fault because they are the ones who made the decision. Meaning to say, we are isolating a certain person or a group of people and give them the argument, you know, focus the argument to them. Kagaya nito, it's all their fault because they are the ones who made the decision. So, ini-exclusive mo sa kanila, okay, yung blame dito sa statement na to. Now, if we have the exclusive, of course, we have the inclusive. Ito naman, wala kang ini-exclude, wala kang ina-isolate, but you include everyone in the inclusive, okay? It is when the writer makes a statement that claims to agree with the audience. It can also make the audience deeply engaged, thus making them agree with the writer. The examples of inclusive words are us, we, you, and ours. Usually, you would hear this technique sa mga politicians, you know, with the way they craft their speeches, kung paano sila manghikayat ng mga tao. Talagang they use this kind of thinking, yung pang kasama sila sa paghihirap, kasama sila sa mga nakakaranasan ng mga tao, yung mga ganun. Ganun sila magsalita, diba? Pang, ang bansa po natin ay sobrang naghihirap na sa mga ganyang mga pangyayari. Kaya po tayo ngayon, magsasama-sama po tayo para matulungan po ang isa't isa. You know, inclusive. Look at the example here. It is time for us to show our belief in friendship and treat people equally. So, inclusive, included yung audience, included yung speaker. So, it's like you're proposing to them that we are one, that we are the same, that we are experiencing the same things. Okay? So, inclusive. And it's very effective for public speeches. Next one is evidence. Of course, it's very important that you can convince people to believe in you by using actual figures, actual facts. You know? So, in evidence, there are different kinds that you can use, and some of these are anecdotal, expert opinion, and statistical evidence. The most basic one, but also the most unreliable one, is the anecdotal. The anecdotal is collecting the evidence informally and relying entirely on personal testimony. In short, an anecdote is a personal testimony, meaning to say it's a story, a personal story. It can be your story, it can also be a story of someone you know, or someone you have heard of, or collected. Nakuha mo, you know, anecdotal. Kagaya nito, when I was a kid, my dog was my best friend. My childhood was better because of him. So this is an anecdotal because it's an evidence that is about a personal story. Yung mga report, yung mga narrative report, yung mga incident report, those are examples of anecdotal evidence. Okay? The next kind of evidence you can use, of course, is the expert opinion. So, from the word expert, meaning professional, the ones who are of authority dun sa topic na yun. So, an example of this is this. Children are becoming more rebellious as they enter puberty, says child psychologist Jean Marie. So here, by the title of the woman, child psychologist, it puts more weight on the opinion children are becoming more rebellious as they enter puberty. Because again, the title gives authority to the opinion. Okay? The next one is, of course, statistical evidence. This is the numerical proof of an argument. It is shown through the bar diagram, graphs, and even just numbers, statistics. A recent survey found that 90% of students favored no school uniforms at all. So you see here the 90% here. So that's an example of a statistical evidence. But it would be better if you could mention the study. Alam niyo, kaya niyong banggitin yung pang. According to a study conducted by ChuChu, o kaya a recent survey by the World Bank states that, mga ganun. Para mas credible. Kasi alam kung saan kinuha yung survey. Kasi pag ganito, yeah, statistical evidence, pero mas maganda kung may source. Okay? Next one is emphasis. So, in emphasis from the word emphasize, you are putting highlights on certain parts of your argument. So, it can be a repetition, accumulation, and alliteration. So, how do these work? First one is repetition from the word repeat. So, you repeat a single word several times over. It can be a single word or a phrase. Actually, even a sentence in your argument. Look at this. We will all suffer for years to come unless we stop this government, stop them in the workplace, stop them at the polls, and stop them on election day. Do you see here? I underlined the repeated word stop because that is the one emphasized by the author or by the speaker. Okay? So that's repetition. You repeat a word or a phrase to make an effect to your audience. Emphasis technique you can use is the accumulation from the word accumulate, pang patong-patong, collected, pang ganun, collected weight or intensity. Okay, so using many similar words in a short space, look at this. This task requires guts, determination, grit, and will power. So you see here, these words, the guts, determination, grit, and will power, they actually mean the same. Halos parehas lang sila ng meaning. But in accumulation, kasi what we do is we give the same words. Pero we order them by intensity, like guts. What is more intense than guts? That's determination. What's more intense than determination? Grit. And what's more intense than grit? That's willpower. But all of these, they are similar words. They almost mean the same. Okay? You just order them by intensity. Para mas magkaroon ng effect sa audience. Parang, you know, parang patinding-patinding effect sa audience mo. The next one is the alliteration, repetition of the first sound in consecutive words, meaning you repeat a sound in your statement. Look at this. To rip people off so blatantly shows Mr. Craven to be cruel, calculating, and crooked. So you see here, the speaker repeated the same sound of the C here. The C in cruel, C in calculating, and C in crooked. So that's the first sound of those words. Inulit. Okay? So, alliteration ang tawag doon. Repeating the same consonant sound in consecutive words. Magkakasunod ang salita. Okay, the next one is the rhetorical question. So, pag sinabi natin rhetorical questions, don't be confused with this. These are types of questions asked to create a dramatic effect or to make a point rather than to get an answer. Meaning, these are questions you ask when you're talking to your audience, but you don't mean to receive an answer. You're just throwing these questions to make them think. Yung parang mag-isip sila na parang, naisip niyo na ba kung anong mangyayari kung walang araw bukas? You know, syempre, when you're talking to an audience, hindi mo naman sila isa-isahin na, ikaw, ano naisip mo? Ikaw, what about you? You're just throwing that question. Tinatanong mo yung question na yun to make them think, to make them engage. Okay? Kasi hindi ka naman pwede mag-start agad by throwing your proposals, your point of view, diba, yung opinion mo. Sometimes you have to get your audience attention, and one of those techniques could be the use of rhetorical question. Okay? You ask them questions, not necessarily to get an answer, pero, you know, to make them think, to engage them in your speech. Okay? Look at this. Do we want our children to grow up in a world where people threaten them with violence on every street corner? So here, if you're going to ask this on a crowd in front of a large audience, of course you would not be expecting to receive answer from them one by one. But instead, you just want them to think. You just want them to get engaged with your speech by, you know, making them think, gusto ba nila yun? Ano bang naisip nila dun sa bagay na yun? Mga ganung bagay. Okay? Next one is generalizations. So, we have talked about this in our logical fallacies, rhetorical fallacies, we could remember the hasty generalizations. But this one is about stereotyping. They are statements or concepts obtained from specific cases. So what we do in generalizations is that we apply a certain idea to other things, you know, just because they are related in some ways. Look at this. A store manager might see one or two teenagers shoplifting and write a letter to the editor claiming all teenagers steal and cannot be trusted. So in this example, a store manager who experiences stealing from teenagers may tag all teenagers to be thieves, you know. Pang common na kalasan niyang manakawan siya ng ilang mga teenagers, ng mga kabataan. Lahat na ngayon ng kabataan para sa kanya ay magnanakaw at hindi dapat pagkatiwalaan. So, that's an example of a generalization. The next one is sensationalism. This is very effective in terms of getting people's interest. Actually, this is being used in journalism. So, mga gamit na gamit sa pagbabalita. Sinesensationalize daw or ginagawang pang clickbait yung mga balita. Okay? So, it presents stories in a way that intends to provoke public interest and or excitement at the expense of accuracy. It leads the audience to believe it is more important, dramatic, and extreme than it is. Ibig sabihin niya, sensationalized. Yung parang, it appeals to your audience interest, senses, ganun, excitement. Ganun. Look at this. One exciting news headline from the newspaper, aspirin may kill you. So, aspirin, of course, is a medicine. We know it as a medicine, something to treat an illness. Pero ang nilagay na headline ng isang newspaper ay aspirin may kill you. Tapos isinulat na nila to in giant, bold, and black letters. Yet in the article, pag binasa mo na yung actual article, we find that the word kill shows that aspirin may kill you if you take 400 tons of it in one gulp. Kumbaga pang kung nag-overdose ka. Okay, so that's an example of sensationalism. Yung pinapala lang maigi yung topic o kaya yung issue para makuha interest ng mga tao. And in fact, sobrang simple lang naman yung bagay na yun. And again, sometimes sensationalism has an effect to the accuracy of the content. Okay? Kasi nga, pinalala lang. Pinaginawa lang siya interesting for the audience. So, that's sensationalism. And again, this is an effective persuasive technique. You know, yung mga simpleng bagay, pag inoeyan mo, pag ginawa mo siyang very interesting, or exciting, di ba? Mga tao mas nakikinig talaga. Next is hypothetical evidence. So, what is this? This is mga what if statements. Yung mga what if the world ends tomorrow. Yung mga ganyan. So, para lang din siyang mga rhetorical question, pero ito naman is making them think about what ifs. Mga what ifs. Di ba kasi pag rhetorical question, it can be any kind of question. Yeah, pwedeng pang yes or no question, open-ended questions. Pero ito, hypothetical evidence is what if statement. Hypothetical evidence because you are parang guessing what could happen. Diba? Kasi nga, what if. So, what if the world ends? Okay, paano kung di kayo nagkatuluyan? Paano yung pupundahan yung bahay? Yung mga ganun. So, hypothetical. Okay, the next one is logic and reasoning. Of course, it's very important that when you persuade people, you use logic. You use valid reasoning. Okay? So, it's reasoning and evidence. Okay? Look at this. If we don't have the resources to support an increased population, we can't sustain this level of immigration. It's that simple. Okay? So, this is logic and reasoning. Kasi nga, if we don't have enough resources, diba, kung wala tayong sapat na pagkukunan ng mga pangangailangan natin to support our increased population, yung malaki nating populasyon, we can sustain a certain level of immigration, yung pag-welcome mo ng mga dayuhan. Diba? So, yun. Basic logic and reasoning. So, meron kang argument at meron kang reason behind your argument. So, that's the most common way of persuading people. Again, by using facts, by using sound reasoning, okay, tamang pagdadahilan. Okay, the next one is figurative language or figures of speech, di ba? As we call this in creative writing. So, one of the figurative language you can use is the use of metaphors. It is a word or phrase applied to an object or action to which it is not applicable. Ibig sabihin, there is a direct comparison between two things and one becomes the other. Look at this. He was on a roller coaster of emotions. So you use here the word roller coaster to refer to the mixture of experiences, you know, yung mixture ng emotions na nakanasan niya, be it going from happy to sad and going back to happy to shocked and all. Kasi nga diba yung roller coaster, yung paikot-ikot siya, kung saan saan ang direction. So, dun mo siya kinumpare, yung experience of having mixed emotions. So, metaphor, okay? The next figure of speech you can use is simile. It's still comparison, but this time you use the words as or like. Look at this. He is as funny as a barrel of monkeys. So, you compare he, the subject, to a barrel of monkeys because they are both funny. Okay? So, that's simile. I think this is very familiar with you. Kasi nga, nadidiscuss naman siya sa ibang mga subjects. Okay? The next figure of speech is hyperbole. Of course, when you try to convince people, being exaggerated is sometimes helpful, di ba? Yung pagiging OA. Example of exaggeration, I am so hungry I could eat a horse, di ba? OA. Parang, sa sobrang gutom ko, kaya kong umubos ng isang kabayo. And we know the size of a horse, di ba? So it's impossible. Next one is, her brain is the size of a pea. Kasing laki lang daw ng parang, ano, butel, yung parang ganun, yung sa may, yung buto ng sitaw, parang ganun, di ba? So, OA, di ba? And exaggeration again helps in persuading people. Kasi minsan, mas naniniwala yung mga tao pag OA yung details, di ba? Yung parang nagiging sensationalized in a way. Okay? The next one is jargon. Okay, probably you've heard of this. Ang ibig sabihin lang nito ay special words or expressions used by a profession or a group that are difficult for others to understand. Meaning, ito yung mga terms or words that are used by a specific group of people lang. Okay? It's usually mga professional. Halimbawa, I need a script to pick up the medicine. So the word script here is a jargon, a medical jargon, of course, for prescription or reseta. Okay? Reseta ng doktor. It's a jargon. Pero maybe for other people like actors, yung mas common sa ating jargon, for actors, for theaters, yung script ay dialogue, di ba? Yung kwento at dialogue ng isang storya. Another one is, your objection is overruled. So these are legal jargons, di ba? The next one is humor. Although this is kind of hard to do because syempre hindi naman sa lahat ng tao benta ang humor natin. Well, if you can use humor, of course that's nice. So this is the quality of being amused or comic, yung pagiging funny, witty, ganun, especially as expressed in literature or speech. So, kagaya nito, totally outraged as a pun on totally outraged when talking about controversial art. Okay? So, totally outraged. Kasi nga, something related to art. Kaya, naging pun siya. Pero ang gusto mo lang sabihin ay totally outraged. Yung parang shook, galit, or basta yun, parang in shock kayo dun sa mga klase ng art na meron. Kasi nga, controversial arts to. Okay? Next one is connotations. Ano ba ang connotations? Surely you've heard of this. The emotional meanings associated with the word are connotations. While writing, the authors often choose their words carefully so that the connotation can suit their purpose. Meaning to say, when you write your speech, when you deliver a message, you carefully choose your words to make sure that the impact is more effective. Kagaya nito, kill and slaughter both mean the same. Diba? Pareha silang pagpatay. Pero yung word na slaughter causes the audience to imagine the act. Diba? Pwede mo kasi sabihin na the man killed the old lady in her house. Pero pag sinabi mong the man slaughtered the old lady in her house, mas nai-imagine mo yung slaughter. Yung parang, ah, okay, baka tinaga. Alam mo yun, yung mga ganong kwento. Diba? Pang mas may effect siya sa mind mo, sa imagination mo. So, connotation. Okay? You choose words which are more imaginable to your audience para mas makuha mo yung attention nila or mas ma-persuade mo sila. Okay? Then we have here the cause and effect. So, of course, basic lang, cause and effect. You start with the cause and then add the effect of the effects afterward. This is particularly concerned with words in a single sentence, although the logic applies if spread across the sentences. Meaning to say, pwede mo siyang ilagay in one statement lang, in one sentence lang, say the cause and the effect, or pwede mo rin siyang ilatag sa iyong paragraph na parang una, nasabihin mo muna yung cause, tapos explain kung ano ba yung cause na yun, and then later the effect na. Okay? So, pwede siyang in one statement or explained well in your essay, in your paragraph. So, cause and effect. Look at this. If I help you, you will be more successful. Diba? So, sobrang effective ng mga ganyan, lalo sa mga nagbebenta ng mga insurance. Diba? Yung mga nagbebenta ng mga product. If you use this, you will become this. If you use this, you will experience this. Yung mga ganyan. Okay? So, cause and effect. So, once again, those are the 16 persuasive techniques you can use. And if you would notice, all those 16 techniques are anchored on Aristotle's ethos, pathos, and logos. Just explained specifically. Okay? So, madali naman sila intindihin, and hopefully you get to use them in your writings when you try to defend a point of view, a belief you have. Okay? Just again, make sure to become ethical when you persuade people. And again, in ethical persuasion, our goals are to understand their viewpoint, to explain your viewpoint, and to come up with a resolution to meet halfway. Okay? Once again, that's our third lesson before the semifinals for purposive communication. See you again on the last lesson. Thank you.